There was a reference to tattooing in Steve's original script, but it wasn't a major sort of metaphorical pivot point of the movie at that point. Viggo Mortensen, who really is an incredible researcher, sent me a book about the idea that in Russian prisons, you don't exist if you don't have tattoos. Your whole life story is written on your body, your criminal history, everything about you. And you're not trusted if you don't have these tattoos that can be read by people in prison, and so they can see who you are, what you are. This book, plus a documentary called The Mark of Cain on Russian prisons and the tattooing that goes on in the prisons, really altered our perception of what the movie was. And in the rewrites that Steve did with me, suddenly the tattoos really crystallized a lot that had been kind of there almost in the script, but not quite.
The tattoo element of the film is based on the reality of an organization called the Vorvi Sekoni, which is the Russian Mafia. A very organized, very tight-knit group of people who express their rank and their history through tattoos.
And typical symbols for Vorvi Sekoni, it's a stars. It's like if you are an officer or if you're a general, you have a certain star on your epaulette.
So you tell Russian desk, you have seen stars over my heart.
If you want to put the star of the Vorvi Sekoni on your chest without a permission, and I am Vorvi Sekoni, I will give an order to my people just to come to you, or I will do it myself with a knife, and I will chop it off those pieces of a skin with those stars, because you do not deserve to have them.
Я вор от рождения. The star's a fucking birthmark for me.
If you're a thief, you have a certain tattoo. If you've committed a murder, you have a certain tattoo. But it's much more complex than that. There's a whole language which is expressed through tattoos, and what I've tried to do is use that in the film.
Я по твоим напарюгам видно, что ты сидел в Сибири. И что ты был вором.
There's a scene, I call it the interview with the vampires, you know, when the criminal higher-ups, when they're asking these questions, the reason the man is sitting there in his underwear in front of these guys in suits, it's not just because it's David Cronenberg and he's going to make a weird scene. It's so that they can look at his tattoos. And if they want to question anything on his body, they can. And if there's any tattoo on your body that you can't answer for, you're in trouble.
Semyon recommends these places for business meeting because you can see what tattoos a man has.
There are people who have done studies of the whole language of it. They're mostly tattoos which are done in prison, and there are a couple of very good books about that. But again, Viggo spent a lot of time with people who live in this world making sure that the tattoos that he had are dead right.
There's an attention to poetic language, to history, and a lot of religious motifs, but they most often don't really have a lot to do with religion. The crucifix that I have on my chest just denotes that I am a thief in good standing. It doesn't really have anything to do with Jesus, necessarily. The church on my back, the three domes represent three different prison sentences, you know. But that's something that those guys would see and know. Just like a spider, if it's climbing upwards, it means one thing. If it's climbing downwards, it means another thing. You're either continuing to be in crime or a certain kind of crime, or you've said, no, I'm not doing it anymore.
The designers on this film have done a fantastic job of getting everything exactly right. So when Viggo takes his shirt off, someone who really is a member of that organization would be able to read what he's done.
Most of the phrases are either exactly or similar to ones I've seen or seen pictures of. There's one that says, "Let all I have lived be as if it were a dream." I wouldn't want to do it over again. It's kind of what it's saying, I suppose, but it's a beautiful way of expressing it. And then some are just amusing. On the instep of my right foot, it says, "Where are you going?" And on the other foot, it says, you know, "What the fuck do you care?" That's really funny. It's like you don't even have respect. One foot doesn't even have respect for the other, you know? This was something we ended up doing a version of. You know, Stefan did something. This was something I sent to him. Basically, in Russian, it says, "I wait." In other words, don't forget about me, no matter who you are.
It's not cluttered, but it's full. It's like a full life. We're saying it's your passport, it's your life, it's your tattoos, and we're carrying through
and
it.
And it's not Rod Steiger.
And it's not Rod Steiger.
Right. This could be a little bigger.
You can get creative, but at the same time, there is a very strict symbology involved. That is, the meanings of these tattoos is very clear. You can't be deceptive with them. You have to tell the truth about who you are.
These tattoos are transfers, basically. And they're applied with hot water. You just peel off the plastic put it on the skin and take a sponge with warm water, and you just put pressure on it, and then you lift the paper, and the transfer will stay there because it's kind of glue-based. And they're touched up with tattoo inks, Illustrator color, and H tattoo pens. What I do is I spray a little bit of flesh color makeup over them to make them look aged a little bit more and not so fresh.
Some of them look older than others. Mm-hmm.
So that's basically the procedure.
It takes a while to apply all these, so there's been times where I've just left them. You know, I've taken a bath and whatever, and then they're still there. Oh, okay, okay. In a pub, there was one time where I was sitting there, and I overheard there was a couple speaking Russian. And I sort of, my ears perked up, and I was just trying to see if I could pick out anything they were saying, just, you know, for my own edification. I was listening for a while, and there was the odd word, and then I understood a couple of things, what they were talking about, a little bit. And all of a sudden, they stopped, like, in a mid-sentence. And I looked around, and they were, like, looking at my hands, but, like, looking really spooked, you know? And I instantly felt really bad, like, oh, they must think I'm eavesdropping, which I was, I guess. And what kind of person was I? And I had just come from work, so my hair was like this, like it is now, and I just probably looked scary to them. On the one hand, I thought, well, good, we're on the right track. On the other, I felt really bad, you know, so I've sort of, you know, like I'll, when we finish this now, I will definitely wash them off.